Thank you. Disciples who worship, serve, and share the gospel of Jesus Christ. On the back of every chair, there is a connection card that we would love for you to fill out. Drop that in the basket later during the service so that we can get in contact with you, let you know a little bit about our church. But on the back of every connect card, there is a place to write a prayer request. Please let us know how we can be praying for you. And so drop that in our basket later during our service as well. We have very short, quick announcements this morning. That's right. Really? All right, so we are starting a new series this morning, 8 questions that Jesus asked. And then the only other announcement is just a reminder, if you signed up for the Women's Open Cup Conference, and you would like to carpool, there is a sign up in the back at the Connect Center. So if you want to work that out, that would be great. Other than that, let's get started this morning. So if you want to join me in prayer, and we'll get going with our service this morning. Lord, this is all for you. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to come here this morning, Lord. So we pray that your Holy Spirit would overwhelm this service. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thank you.
stand up, find someone you have not said good morning to, and say good morning, and we will begin with our worship.
Good morning.
Thank you. Let's read together today. We're going to read from Daniel 7, 13, and 14. And it says, "In my vision at night I looked, and there before me was one like a son of man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worshipped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed." Amen.
Questions Jesus asked. Not answered, but asked. Now, in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, in the first part of the New Testament, Jesus asked more than 8 questions. Sometimes we always think about Jesus and how he answered things, but he also asked things of people. And so, through this series, we're going to be looking at why he asked these questions in particular, what he meant from getting out of them, and how did people respond to answering them. So if you have your Bibles, you can open up, because we're going to be starting in Matthew 16 this morning, Matthew 16, 13. And we're going to be looking at probably, in the series, probably the most important question right off the bat. That he asks the disciples, and he first says, who do the people say the Son of Man is? And then he asks the disciples, who do you say I am? He asks kind of the same question in 2 different kind of ways to 2 different types of people that would be listening and what he wanted to see their answer would be. So I'm excited about this series. I think we're going to get really in-depth in Scripture and looking at what God has for us. If you had been here the kind of the winter, spring leading into Easter, we just got done doing a series on the life of Joseph. And I think it was a great series to kind of walk through his life. I love teaching from the Old Testament. If you're not an Old Testament fan, which as a Christian you should be, it's just great. It's so rich with stories and what God has done to continue to even get us to this point of redeeming mankind from the sin that we have been walking in. In the last 2 weeks in Palm Sunday and Easter, we talked about how Jesus got rejected, but then how he was redeeming the whole world and being vindicated. And the last 3 springs, if you have been here the last 3 springs, if you're new, welcome. But the last 3 springs, each spring, I try to do a series just strictly on Jesus, his life, what he did, and stuff like that. So if you were here like 3 years ago, for those of you who were here 3 years ago, let's see, show of hands if you were here 3 years ago. Okay, so about half, maybe a little over half, were here 3 years ago. I did the miracles of Jesus. We walked through 8 or 9 different miracles of Jesus. If you were here 2 years ago, we talked about the parables of Jesus. And last year, we talked about the messianic claims of Jesus, the I am statements. Well, this year, we're talking about 8 questions Jesus asked. And so I find the springtime to be a great time to say, hey, let's dive into Jesus, what he did, you know, who he talked to, and the life that he led. And I think it's so important for us to be there and walk through that with him as we study his scripture. And so let's go ahead and pray and pray for our morning. Lord, we love you, Father. We thank you. God, we just pray for your guidance, your direction as we read through your scripture, God. May it be proclaimed, Lord, not just in this room, and our hearts that have accepted you, but God, beyond these walls, that we are the church wherever we go, that we bring your message wherever we go, and that, Lord, we bring your love with us, that it should be in truth and love of your word, not what I think, but God, what you think. And so, Lord, I pray that we see that revealed in our hearts and revealed in this question this morning, Lord. Father, we love you, we thank you, in your name, amen. Amen. My dad asked me a very important question when I was younger. And in life, parents can ask their kids these questions, and it sticks out to them as being important questions. And so my dad asked me a very simple question. Joel, what do you want to be when you grow up? Now, that's kind of a loaded question for a little kid. I was born in 79. Back in the 80s, most kids in general would have answered something along the lines of being a policeman or a firefighter or a soldier or a doctor or a lawyer. All the kind of things that you get the toys from because they're so common back then. My son Asher, years ago, when we lived back in Utah in Park City, my wife asked Asher, someday, what do you want to be when you grow up? And Asher answered, I want to be a fire truck. Not a fireman, a fire truck. And so you can get wide-ranging answers, but my answer to my father was, I want to be a jet fighter pilot. Back in the 80s, like if you watched cartoons or commercials or TV shows or what's that? Top Gun. Anything like that. I was too young to watch Top Gun. My parents did not let me watch Top Gun in the 80s. I was just a kid. But you see commercials, anything for it, I wanted to fly an F-15. Like, I mean, it was like, that was my dream. And so, like, as I grew up, my dad, I had 2 model planes I had put together of F-15s that I had painted and put together. Like, you see the model planes that you can do back then. It was so much popular back then than I think it is today. But I loved that kind of stuff. And so when I was growing up, my dad asked me that. My first thought was, this is what I want to do. when someone important asks you a question like that in life, it makes you kind of stop in life and say, what is the answer to this? Like, why do I want to do that? Why is this person asking this question in my life? Especially when they are important in your life. Because it makes you reconsider things. It makes you think deeper on things. It makes you go past the surface level because that person that's asking in your life is important in your life. You want to give a response of like, hey, let me think about that for a second. What do I really think? What do I really believe? And when Jesus asks these questions to the disciples this week, he wants them to think about what is in their heart. What do they truly see Jesus to be? Now, you would think they're his disciples. They're following Jesus. And in many ways, they want to see him as the Messiah. They long to see him as the Messiah. They're just still uncertain if he is the Messiah. I mean, we can see it all the way up until Jesus' death. They scatter. They hide in an upper room because they're afraid and they're just not. They think it's over. Maybe he wasn't. So we know, rewinding, because hindsight's 20/20, we get to look back on something that they did. When Jesus asked this question in Matthew 16, he's having them investigate their own heart of, who do I think this person is? And why do I think that? Sometimes I think that we have to investigate that in our own life as believers even for today. We've talked about this in past series, but it's going to come up in this series as well. And it's going to come up today as well, too. Do you believe Jesus to be Messiah and Lord, or do you just believe him to be Messiah? Has he met your expectations, or is he meeting his own expectations of what he wants to do? Because really the reality is, Jesus throughout the Gospels, when he does something, when he heals someone, more often than not, he tells them to go and don't tell anybody. It's called kind of the silent part of the Gospels, where Jesus tells them don't tell anybody. And we're going to talk about why he does that, because more often than not, what he's telling them is, I want you to believe with your heart who I am, not just because I did a magic trick for you, not just because I performed a miracle, but do you truly believe in me? Not just because of what I can do. We pray this often, or at least I pray this often with you guys. Lord, we love you not just because of what you have done. I mean, that's a good blessing, like be thankful for what God has done. There's nothing wrong with that. But Lord, even more importantly, we love you because of who you are. And in this question today, Jesus is asking the disciples, do you love me because of who I am, not just because of the miracles I can do? Like, do you love God in the deepest parts of your heart and say, God, you are it for me? And so when he asks that question, it's really important for us to think through, is this the love that I have for God, or what he was testing? Because the first time he asked, who do the people say the Son of Man is? They had a whole bunch of different answers. Because Jesus didn't come in the way that he wanted. Jesus didn't do the things that they wanted him to do. So do you love him for who he is and the way he went about it? Or do you love him for what your expectation is and what he might do for you later? That was the deciding question here with the disciples. And so this morning, as we start our eight questions Jesus asked and how they will change your life, we're looking at who do you say I am? And in verse 13, it says this, we begin to read. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, that's a tongue twister for me, he asked his disciples. Now, before we get to him asking, go ahead and flip it to the next slide. This is what it looked like in this area. That little arrow right there, is all the way up there, is where they're at. All right. I like to show maps just to get kind of an identification of as Jesus traveled, where Bethlehem was, where Jerusalem was. Bethlehem and Jerusalem are way down there by the Dead Sea. So he's up north, and we think, how far is that? We're talking probably roughly 70, 80 miles in that sense. But in 70, 80 miles, not having a car, he's not riding a horse. He walked everywhere. One thing I always thought for sure, I used to tell youth kids this because I was a youth pastor for a long, Jesus was in wicked good shape. I mean, that man walked everywhere. Probably never ate sugar like how we did today. He was probably in tremendous shape. He probably was. So that's the picture of it right there. And then he asked his disciples this question. Who do people say the Son of Man is? Now, this is the first part. He asks this question twice, but he states it differently each time. And it brings us to our first point for this morning. Jesus knows who he is. He's not asking this question. Well, it's important that we discuss this, because he's not asking this question because sometimes as insecure people, we can go to those who we trust the most and say, hey, what do you think about what I did? Or what do you, who, like, do you like me? Like, you know, like, we have insecurities. We can go to the people closest to us and ask them what they think about us. That's not what Jesus is doing. Jesus knows who he is. And how do we know that? Well, besides we know scripture and know that he's fully God and fully man, he's stating who he is in the question. You see, in the Gospels, Jesus says Son of Man about himself 81 times in the Gospels. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. About himself. He's actually the only person in the Gospels that even says it. And he says it about himself 81 times. And it comes from Scripture in the Old Testament in Daniel 7. Daniel 7, 13 and 14 that we read before earlier says, in my vision at night I looked, and there before me was one like a son of man. Coming with the clouds of heaven, he approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worshipped him. His dominion is everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. So Jesus, even in the question, is actually telling him who he is. Man, he's smarter than I am. I mean, to put something like that, to phrase something like that, is very powerful. Jesus here used this term as a messianic title that he was promoting about himself throughout the Gospels and even here in this question. John 13, 3 says, Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power. So we're getting to the point, like, Jesus knew who he was, he knew what he was sent to do, and so in this question, it was more about what the disciples were thinking and where their hearts were at than Jesus being insecure and saying, man, hey, can you tell me who I am? Because I'm not sure. So Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God. He knew his mission. He knew why he was there. He knew who he was. He knew from the very beginning, even when we look at John 1:1, when it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus knew confidently, I know who I am, but do you? If I'm not meeting your expectations, do you still love me with all your heart? If I don't do a magic trick for you and heal your cancer, are you still going to love me? Like, I want us to stop and think about that for a second, because that is the question that every Christian needs to ask in their heart. If everything that you have was taken away, like Job, if you know the book of Job in the Old Testament, if everything that you have was taken away, would you still love God? You see, Job had this long-lasting conversation for many chapters. If you read through the book of Job, going all the way through Job 40 plus, and he had this long conversation where three friends come and say, you must have sinned. He's like, I didn't sin. I don't know why this has happened. And finally, Job gets so frustrated because he's practically lost everything. He goes before God and says, he begins to question God. God, why? And it's one of the most powerful, if you've never read the book of Job in the Old Testament, you need to read it. It's one of the most powerful stories you can read in all the Bible. Because in the last part of the book of Job, God comes to him and he says something that we all have probably heard a pastor speak on before. God comes to Job and says, where were you when I put the foundations of the world? Where were you when I knit you in your mother's womb? Where were you when I did all of this? And Job comes to the realization that even if I lost everything, it was God that gave and it's God that can take away. And so what Jesus is getting here with the disciples is in asking this question is, who whether you had a predetermined idea of what the Messiah should have been like or not, do you know who I am? Because I am, I am. And it's a very powerful question that he's stating here. And so Jesus knows who he is. He knows what his mission is. He knows what he's about. He knows why he's there. And so there's no lost in translation here that we see. And so in verse 14, he says, they replied, some say John the Baptist. Others say Elijah. And still others, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. It brings us to point number two. Jesus knows others will see anything but God. The reason why Jesus is asking this, he asks it in two different ways. It's like asking today people who are unbelievers, not Christians, who do you say the Son of Man is? Who do you say Jesus is? And then the second part would be, eventually when we get here in a second, Jesus comes in here and says to the believers, who do you say? And so for Jesus, he knows others will see anything but God. He knows the response will be different. Notice the response is John the Baptist, Elijah, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets, but they don't say God. It's not God. The people around, and why is that? Because Jesus wasn't meeting their expectations of what they thought he should be. And what was that? Riding on the white chariot of fire coming in to rid them of the Romans. And so he asked this question of, can you accept me as Messiah and Lord, as who I am and what I'm doing, or is what your expectation is getting in the way? That's a big question, again, that we have to ask as believers, as Christians. Is your expectation of what God should do in your every circumstance getting in the way of you worshiping God in every circumstance? It's interesting. These are people who want the Messiah to come, but only if he comes in the way they want him to come. You see, the Messiah is right in front of them, and they see everything else but the Messiah. You know, one of the hardest things for humans to do sometimes is to see the truth that's right in front of them, because it's not dressed up in the way that they want it to be. You see, Jews saw Jesus as a heretic. Muslims see Jesus as a great teacher. Mormons see Jesus as one of many gods. Agnostics see Jesus as a good guy. But Christians, we are called to see Jesus as Savior. I'm not sure I knew I was putting out a slide. John 1:11 says this, he came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Jesus came fully man, also fully God, but came fully man, and his own did not receive them. Why? Because it was about their expectations, not actually what God was truly actually doing. And going back to why Jesus asked this question. And so simply, the question that they're all trying to answer is simple. Which way do you get to heaven if there is a heaven? That's why this question Jesus asked is so important. Who do people say the Son of Man is? Because if you truly understand who the Son of Man is, going back to Daniel 7, as he's referring to himself, he is the Messiah that brings glory. It says in Daniel 7, he is the anointed one that will rule. And so do you trust him for who he is, or your expectation of who you want him to be? That's the heart of this question. And so in verse 15, as we read on, it says this, but what about you, he asked. Now, we're getting into the second part of the, almost the same question, but he phrases it a little bit different. He says, what about you, he asked, who do you say I am? Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And it brings us to point number three. Jesus wants the disciples to see him as Messiah and Lord. Not just someone who has saved, but someone who we follow. Not just someone who we worship on Sunday, but is Lord of our life Monday through Saturday. Not just someone who we say, you are amazing, you've done everything, I praise you for all that you've done, but I'm not praising you for who you are. Because let's make it very clear, when you worship and follow God as Lord, not just Savior, you are declaring, I worship you for who you are. Because all the things that you have done can be taken away, and I'm still going to worship you for who you are. That's what it means to say Jesus is my Lord and Savior. He came as Messiah, but he also came to be everybody's Lord, because he's the only one that can, because he's the only one that is powerful enough to take away sins because of what he did on the cross. And so it's so important in our hearts and in our life that it's not just Messiah, because we see many Christians that accept Christ as Messiah, as Savior, but then continue to live the way that they want and don't actually follow him as Lord. And it's so important that we follow him as Lord just as wholeheartedly as the day that we accepted him as Savior and Messiah. That's what he's declaring. So Jesus wants the disciples to see him as Messiah and Lord. In this question, that's why he's begging this question, do you see me for who I am, who I am saying to you I am right in front of you, or are you still lost in what your expectations were previously? Because a lot of them had it. A lot of them had different expectations. Do you believe the world, or do you believe me? You know, the term Mashiach, or Messiah, refers to a future Jewish king. This is what the Jews kind of walked through and thought through. From the Davidic line, who is expected to save the Jewish nation, and he will be anointed with holy anointing oil and rule the Jewish people during the Messianic age. It's interesting because Simon Peter answers this question, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. But later in John 20, verse 28, Thomas answers this question too. Thomas said to him, my Lord, my God. Notice, Simon Peter says Messiah, but Thomas says Lord. And what Jesus wants from them when he asks this question is so important for us even today, is to be your Messiah, your Savior, the one who rescues you from sin, but he also wants to be your Lord in all of your life. This question isn't just a simple question. This question gets at the root and at the heart of every single person that has ever lived and ever will live. Of what you see when you see Jesus. Do you see him as Lord and Savior, as King and as Creator of all the universe? Or do you see him as just a magic show side trick that did some miracles? And try to prove himself. Verse 17, Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. You see, Peter's confession of who Jesus was shows a God-given deeper insight in his heart that's beginning to stir. He's acknowledging what others won't. Notice the two different types of answers that are given. When Jesus asked the disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? They list off everybody but God. And when I say everybody, that's figuratively speaking, but the importance of figures in the Old Testament. But Simon Peter's answer is very clear. You are Lord, you are the Son of God. And so he's beginning to realize in his heart that something in the disciples, see, here's the thing. Most people think after Jesus died on the cross, when the disciples were hidden, that when Jesus showed himself, they did a complete 180. And in some aspects they did, but I would say Jesus had already begun that 180 in their life before he ever went on the cross. In the different questions and the different teachings that he was giving the disciples, he was beginning to stir different things in the disciples in their hearts to begin realizing who he was. Now their hope and their trust in who that was when Jesus finally revealed himself and showed them the scars and let them touch him, sat down and ate with them, everything that we talked about last week, finally came to fruition where they're 100%. But it didn't go from 0 to 100% when Jesus rose from the dead with the disciples. All through the 3 years that they were walking with them, their hearts were changing more and more every day when they were with them. by questions like this, being stirred to think about different answers, being stirred to think about what do people say, what do I think, and why. Like, change in our life, like, this is one of the things that we have to realize, and I'm going to say this two ways for us this morning. Changing your life is not going to happen oftentimes just overnight. But this is the second way that we have to look at it too. Change in other people's life is not going to happen overnight either. Because we love to think, man, why don't they just change? But then we struggle with that change ourselves. And what Jesus was doing for 3 years with the disciples was investigating their heart and where they were at. Teaching them, discipling them, letting them learn from him. So that when he did raise from the dead, it wasn't going from 0 to 100. But man, they were already going there. But it was like the final, like, cross, like, nail on the cross for them was fully on board. Like, this is it. That's why the disciples left that room, and every single one of them died a martyr's death. Because they knew, they saw, Jesus spent 40 days, he's shown himself to over 500 people, all the stuff that we talked about last week for Easter. He ate with them, he taught them, he talked about prophecy, that he would fulfill prophecy, that he would set himself. He did all these things, and they are finally saying, yes, you are Lord and you are Savior. You're not just Savior, you are Lord in my life. See, when he becomes Lord in your life, things in your life begin to change. This is one of the things that I've seen within Christianity and I've seen within the law. When he becomes Messiah in your life, the reality of sin and what he has done has changed where you are going in that acceptance. But when he becomes Lord of your life is when you're going to start to see your life change more. And when you start to say, God, whatever your commands are, I'm going to begin to obey your commands. I just don't love you because you saved me. I'm going to love you because of everything you are, and I'm going to begin obeying your commands, and I'm going to let that change my life. My works aren't going to save me. I'm going to have works because I am saved. I'm going to love you because of who you are. And so when Jesus asks this question, who do you say the Son of Man is? It's very simple in the response. As he comes back, he's like, you are everything to me. You should be everything to everybody. See, up until this point, the disciples' understanding of the nature of Jesus' messiahship was hindered by their own expectations of what the Messiah would look like. He's not asking this question for all the unbelievers around him. Jesus is asking this question for the believers that are following him right in front of him. He's asking this question for every single person sitting in here. When you leave today, who do you say the Son of Man is? Do you have a clear and focused answer for that? In verse 18 it says, I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Then he ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. And it brings us to the point number four, and the final point for this morning is this: Jesus wants true faith. That's why he's asking this question. Jesus didn't want the reason someone converted to following him. This is why he often told people, go and don't tell anybody, after he did a miracle, because Jesus didn't want the reason for someone to convert and follow him to be because of nationalistic fervor or wrong expectation. Why? Because he knew that it wouldn't last, and it wouldn't be with their heart, but only in their minds, because they got to see a miracle. He wanted their faith, their obedience, and their submission to him for who he actually was, not just their predetermined expectations of before. Do you love the Lord for who he is? Jesus was asking if they had true faith. R.C. Sproul's pastor also put it this way: true faith always produces real conformity to Christ. Real conformity to Christ. That does not mean that you get to do whatever you want. Real conformity to Christ says, I'm going to start living like him. I'm going to start speaking like him. I'm going to control my tongue. I'm going to control my temper. I'm going to love those who don't love me. I'm going to pray for those who hate me. And I'm going to do all this because it's the example that Jesus set for me. He set the example. Some of us are still content to live our life the way that we want. And we're not living our life the way that Jesus has asked you to live your life. Which means complete, not 99%. It means complete 100% conformity to Him. And to not be ashamed of the gospel, because I'm just going to tell you right now, the world is always going to hate the gospel. The world is always going to hate God. The world is always going to want to be its own God. And so if we know that to be true, then we might as well stand up for what we know to be true, because no matter what you say, it's always going to hate you back. And that's why Jesus said, but don't hate that back, love back. I mean, what was the one of the final things that Jesus said on the cross? Lord, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Jesus set the example. He wants true faith. How did Jesus answer the question even for himself? Well, John 14:6, one of the most popular verses in the entire Bible, Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. He made it very clear. One of the most famous verses of all time, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. I'm so used to the King James Version. Growing up, it was King James for me. Like, he knew it himself. He answered it himself. He answered it in the question. He wants to see where you're at. Jesus doesn't have, I should have started off with this. So over the next week, 8 weeks, like, let's be very clear with this. Jesus doesn't ask a question that he doesn't already know the answer to. He's asking the questions for the people that are in front of him, around him, so that they may begin to figure things out in their own heart about him and what he's doing and why. That's what he does. That's what he did. That's what he does today in our own hearts and our own lives. Jesus makes it clear throughout the gospel he wants true faith, a faith that believes in him because of who he is, not just because of something he might have done. And again, it takes it back to what I pray all the time. Lord, we do thank you for what you've done, but man, we better praise you for who you are. Because who you are has produced what you've done. And it is such a sharp reminder for us as Christians. D.L. Moody said it this way. Moody Bible Institute is a Bible college in Chicago that my dad went to years ago. He said, real true faith is man's weakness leaning on God's strength. He wants true faith that in all moments, in every moment, in weakness or in strength, he wants us to lean on him and follow him and rely on him for all things. You see, faith is confidence in God's grace and his nature more than just a miracle that he may do. And so when he asks this question that we just got done discussing this morning, he's asking the question, not just who people say the Son of Man is. He's stating who he is. He wants you to investigate your heart. That's why he goes one step further to the disciples and then says, who do you say I am? It's not about what the outside world's going to say, because the outside world's going to make it very clear to you. I don't care who. That's why Jesus said, investigate your own heart and say, who do you say he is? Do you believe that he is the Son of Man? Do you believe that he is the Savior, the Messiah, the one that has spoken from all the prophecies of the Old Testament up until now? Do you believe that he is the one that was sent from God, the Father? And do you believe that he is the Lord of your life too? That's what Jesus is getting at with this question. So this morning is very simple. Who do you say Jesus is? Jesus asks the question in your heart, who do you say Jesus is? And maybe for many of you, you've accepted Christ as Savior, as Messiah. But are you truly living like he's your Lord? That's the question Jesus asked. Do you live like I'm your Lord? Do you live like you truly love me and love people? I mean, what was the greatest commandments when Jesus was asked? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. Do you actually live that way question for a Christian's life. Let's pray. Lord, Father, we love you, God. As we look at communion this morning, God, to partake in the sacrifice that you made, God, that was so... Sin is so devastating to the world, God. Sometimes we love to downplay what it is. But you bore the sins of the world on the cross. You took them to the grave, and you defeated them once and for all. So, God, as we celebrate something that was so damning and something that was so damaging to the world, but we celebrate it because you overcame it. And when you sat with the disciples and broke the bread and gave them wine and told them to take of it, Lord, you are setting an example for us to follow for the rest of eternity of what you had done in this life. You had loved those who hated you. You came in a way that no one expected, but you came in a way that brought peace, that brought grace, that brought love, that gave us an eternity with you. And we are forever grateful. So God, I pray as we come forward to receive the communion and go back to our seats, God, I pray right now that our hearts would be right before you. That we don't just see you as Messiah and Savior, but we see you Lord of all. That when you pose that question even for us today, who do you say the Son of Man is? God, may we say that you are my Messiah, and that you are my King, and that you are my Lord. Because nothing would be here if it wasn't for you. God, I pray that we have that revelation in our heart. Father, we love you and we thank you in your name. Amen. We're going to be taking communion. And communion is a time for Christians, if you're a believer in here, it's a time for Christians to partake in what Jesus called what we call the Last Supper, where Jesus broke the bread and he poured the wine and talked about the sacrifice that he was about to make for them in the final time that he was with them. So we're going to have the ushers release you from the back to come up and partake, or come up and take. Go back to your seats, and then we're going to partake of it all together.
Thank you.
Jesus was betrayed. He took the bread and he broke it. He said, "This is my body, broken for you. As often as you eat it, do so in remembrance of me." He then lifted the cup. He said, "This is my blood, shed for you for the remission of sins. As often as you drink it, do so in remembrance of me." Let's pray. Father, as we participate in your meal, let us connect more with you as members of your family, knowing that we have been fully forgiven, that your mercy reigns in our life as we trust you as our Lord and Savior. So, Father, as we come before you this morning, let us humble ourselves and put ourselves in our rightful place with you at the top. Lord, this is all for you. In Jesus' name.
As the ushers come forward this morning, I was reminded of a story during the sermon this morning, and you'll probably figure this out. There was a young teenager was asking his dad for a new car, and his dad says, "I'm not giving you a new car until you cut your hair." So the teenager comes back pretty quickly. He says, "You know, Jesus had long hair." And his father says, "You know, Jesus walked everywhere he went too." Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for this message. I pray, Lord, that we would recognize who you are. I pray, Lord, that would be the question that we would ask ourselves and ask our friends and our families. Who do you say that Jesus is? And I think that's a very important question for us, Lord. And we know, Lord, that at one point in history, all knees were bowed to you, all tongues were confessed that you are Lord Jesus. Even those that had not professed before, everyone will bow and kneel to you. And those that have not taken you as Lord and Savior, Lord, that will go away with regret. I pray, Lord, that we can witness those people and show them just who you really are. Lord, we thank you for this service this morning, this sermon, Lord. I ask you to bless these gifts and the givers. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Finish down the aisle, we can stand and join. So I have a daughter, she's a sophomore at Florida State, and in February at Florida State, they had it's got some holes out there, they had a revival in the Civic Center. They had 4,500 students show up, and they had 300 to 400 students jump in the famous Westcock Fountain at Florida State University and be baptized. So it's all because of this war. It's all because of the splendor and the glory of this amazing God we serve. And for anyone that needs to hear it, he wants you to come. The debt has been paid. Don't hold on to the guilt and the shame. He doesn't want that for you. The price has already been paid for our great, amazing God. Let's sing together.
All the earth rejoice. Darkness tries to hide. He trembles at his voice. Trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all the sea, how great is our God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The prophet we
have a great rest of your day.